We're going to look at the life cycle hypothesis. Ando and Modigliani have formulated a consumption function which is known as the life cycle hypothesis. According to this hypothesis, consumption is a function of lifetime expected income of the consumer. The consumption of the individual consumer depends on the resources available to him, which consist of his income and wealth, both the current and expected income. Before we go into the theory, let's look at what the assumptions are. The life cycle hypothesis is based on the following assumptions. First of all, there is no change in the price level during the lifetime of the consumer. The rate of interest paid for his assets is zero. The consumer does not inherit any assets, and what net assets he owns are the result of his own savings. His current savings result in future consumption. He intends to consume his total lifetime earnings plus current assets, which means that he does not plan any bequests on his children. There is certainty about his present and future flow of income. The consumer has a definite conscious vision of his life expectancy, that is the number of years he is expected to live. He is aware of the future emergencies, opportunities and social pressures which will impinge upon his consumption spending. Finally, the consumer is rational, which means that the aim of the consumer is to maximize his utility over his lifetime, which will in turn depend on the total resources available to him during his lifetime. Now, given these assumptions and given the lifespan of an individual, his consumption is proportional to these resources. As the resources increase, his consumption increases and vice versa. But the proportion of these resources that the consumer plans to spend will depend on whether the spending plan is formulated during the early or the later year of his life. An individual's average income is relatively low at the beginning of his life and also at the end of his life. This is because in the early years of his life, he has very little wealth, and during the late years, his labor income is very low, or he depends on his pension. It is, however, in the middle of his life that his income, both from assets and labor, is high. And as a result, the consumption level of the individual throughout his life is somewhat constant or slightly increasing. Now let's look at this in the form of a diagram. The x-axis shows the consumption level of the individual, and the y-axis shows the lifetime of the individual consumer. The y0y1 curve shows the individual consumer's income stream during his lifetime t. The cc1 curve is the consumption during his lifetime. During the early period of his life, represented by t1, he borrows or dissaves CY0B amount of money to keep his consumption level CB, which is almost constant. In the middle years of his life, represented by T1, T2, he saves BSY amount of money to repay his debt and for the future. And in the last years of his life, represented by T2T, he dissaves SC1Y1 amount. So in the early and in the late years of his life, he has this savings, that is negative amount of savings, meaning that he consumes more than what he receives as income. And during the middle years of his life, he has positive savings, which means he earns more than what he consumes. The life cycle hypothesis reveals that the savings change over the lifetime of a consumer. If a consumer starts his life in adulthood with no wealth, he will save and accumulate wealth during his working years. But during retirement, he will dissave and run down his wealth. Thus, the life cycle hypothesis implies that the consumer wants smooth and uninterrupted consumption over his lifetime. During working years, he saves, and when he retires, he dissaves. The theory is considered to be superior to other hypotheses on the consumption function, but it is not free from certain criticisms. First of all, the plan for lifetime consumption is unrealistic. So the contention of Ordo and Modigliani that consumer plans his consumption over his lifetime is unrealistic because a consumer concentrates more on the present rather than on the future, which is uncertain. The consumption is also not directly related to the assets. The life cycle hypothesis presupposes that consumption is directly related to the assets of an individual. And as assets increase, his consumption increases and vice versa. This is also unwarranted because an individual may reduce his consumption to have larger assets. Thirdly, the consumption depends on attitude. Consumption depends upon one's attitude towards life. Given the same income and assets, one person may consume more than the other. The consumer is also not rational and knowledgeable. The hypothesis that assumes that a consumer is rational and has full knowledge about his income as well as his future income is unrealistic because no consumer is fully rational and knowledgeable in the real world. And fifthly, estimation of variables such as the current income, value of assets, future expected labor income and so on is very difficult and is not possible. Then there's also the existence of liquidity constraints for consumer. Even if he possesses a definite and conscious vision of his future income, he may have little opportunity for borrowing in the capital market on the basis of expected future income. And as a result, consumption may respond more to changes in the current income than predicted on the basis of life cycle hypothesis. Finally, it neglects the locked up savings. This theory neglects the role of locked up savings in consumption. It regards savings as a pool from which people spend up consumption over the lifetime. In fact, people keep their savings in locked up form in mutual funds, pension plans, life insurance, etc. So the theory has not considered all these factors. But on the whole, the life cycle hypothesis is more superior to the other hypothesis on consumption function.